Good morning. We have gathered in the presence of God, in the midst of God's people, to ask that His Spirit would fall upon us, that we might worship in spirit and in truth. Just a few announcements as we begin this morning. A reminder that this evening we will have a combined Labor Day service with the area Christian Reformed and Reformed congregations. We invite you to come back this evening. I will be speaking on what it means to work for the glory of God. Also note, upcoming later on in the month, we have a special offering for the victims of the earthquake in Haiti. We ask that you would consider what God lays upon your hearts and that you might give generously to the needs of those in that stricken nation. Looking through some of our prayer concerns, again, we want to extend sympathy to Farland and the family on the passing of his brother Rod. We pray that the Spirit would comfort and strengthen in this time. We want to be in prayer for Gord Feenster as he will undergo shoulder surgery. That's one of those words that I can't take. On Thursday, continue to pray for Tom Gerlach. He is home in the recovery process, as well as others in the church in need of our prayers. Jessica and Chad and Beth and Marie and others who need a touch of the great physician's hand. As we gather in worship now, I invite you to join me in this call to worship. Happy are we when we walk in your ways, O Lord. Happy are we when we walk in your ways, O Lord.
You bring forth fruit in due season and establish the work of our hands.
Happy are we when we walk in your ways, O Lord.
Who is like our God, the one whose ways are full of life.
Happy are we when we walk in your ways, O Lord.
Come before me.
Father, receive the sacrifice of praise that it is offered from our lips, from our hearts, from our minds, from our whole selves. Gather us into your presence. Attune our hearts to sing your praise, that we might glorify you and receive blessing in turn. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand as we worship the Lord together. We have come into his house.
We
and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome your brothers and sisters this morning. Let's continue our worship. Peace that endures. That is the promise made to us by Christ himself. We take hold of that promise today as together we come and we confess our sin. Gracious and loving God, we live in a constant state of conflict. You have called us to walk by the Spirit, but we choose to gratify our sinful desires. We know what is good and right and holy, but our rebelliousness pushes us to the acts of evil. We confess our sinfulness. We acknowledge our brokenness. We cry out for your mercy. By the power of your Spirit, help us to embrace your goodness. May we be filled anew with your Spirit and bear the fruit of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Come together and let us pray. Father, we come. We come to that firm foundation, away from the sinking sand of a sinful world around us that threatens to pull us in. We come to the rock. We stand firm upon the truth of your word. We build upon the foundation which Christ has laid for us, and we aspire to be building blocks in that holy temple that is even now being built, longing for the day of completion in the day of your Son's return. Father, we come to you as a refuge in the storm. We come to you seeking comfort in our sorrow. We draw near to the throne of grace seeking help in our time of need. Yet, Father, we do not come this day empty-handed. We bring praise. We bring you honor and glory. We lift your name on high, not only for what you have done, but more importantly, for who you are. We are grateful for that abounding love that draws in even the wayward sinner. We are astounded by an amazing grace that covers even the worst of our thoughts and makes us whiter than snow. We are compelled by your mercy to show mercy to others. And we ask that the heart of Jesus beat within our own lives, that we might love as he loved, that we might show the same grace that we have received, that we might extend mercy, that we might love you and love our neighbor as ourselves. Father, as we come today, we have the turning of a calendar page. We are fast approaching the end of the summer months, a time for many of rest and relaxation, a time of vacation and getting away from the routine. But now we are returning to a regular schedule. Our young people are back in school, and we pray that as they begin this new school year, as little kindergartners coming through the door or college students venturing out into the world, that you would be with them, that you would guide them with wisdom and knowledge, that you would give to the teachers the talents and the gifts that they need in order to instruct your children in the way of truth, in the way of your word. Father, as the work schedules begin to fall into that common rhythm of 9 to 5, may we on this Labor Day weekend be reminded that we are to do all things to your praise, honor, and glory, that we are working not for a paycheck, but for you. For work is a good gift given at the beginning, and even though twisted by sin, even now work is a good thing. Father, we pray for those who are returning to the regular work schedule. We pray for those, Father, who are looking for work. We pray that of the abundance of jobs, there may be a connection with those who want to work. We pray, Father, for those who are unable to work for a variety of reasons, Lord, that you would provide for them and that you would instill in each one a sense of dignity, a sense of ambition, a desire to labor unto you and your kingdom. Father, for others, this is just a continuation of the days that have gone before. Not much really changed over the summer. But Lord, we pray that even in the routine, there might be moments when we might catch glimpses of your grace, that we might see a sliver of your glory and be reminded that life is a blessing, that it is a gift from you to be received and cherished. Father, we think of the events just in the last few days with the new law in Texas, the ruling of the Supreme Court. Father, once again, we see the partisan divide in our nation, yet we are paused by any who would think that it's a good thing to allow just the senseless murder of children in the womb. Father, this is a reason to rejoice that we have one more step toward the preservation of life in all of its various extremes. Yet we know, Father, that sometimes it is difficult for those who are facing choices, Lord. And we pray that you would be very present in the midst of that choice, and that you would raise up brothers and sisters in Christ who would come alongside families who are worried about the choices that they make, that we may show that we are committed to life in all circumstances and in all ways. Father, this is an age for the church to arise. In an age of partisan politics, in an age of ever-increasing perversion, in an age when many are drifting from the truth of your word, now is the time for the church to arise anew, as it has done throughout the ages, to stand firmly upon the word of God, knowing that it will withstand all the assaults of the enemy, and that the gates of hell will not prevail, but they will continue to fall as your truth is marching on. Father, we join the ranks of those who march under the banner of your truth, for we are walking in victory today, longing for the day when the whole creation will know that Jesus Christ is Lord. Father, on that day when the trumpet sounds, the angel calls, and the sky is rolled back as a scroll, Lord, we want to be counted in that number. We want to be part of those who are on the Lord's side, those who have already willingly bent the knee and proclaimed that Jesus is Lord. Father, be with those believers in Afghanistan and other parts of the world who are facing the real possibility of torture and death. Lord, we see even now that the church in Afghanistan is growing bold. Even as they face death, they do so with an eagerness to share the good news. Father, may we pray for their security. May we pray for their strength. And may we pray a little bit of their spirit might be found in the church in this country even today. Father, hear now the prayers of your people, bounded up in our thoughts, in our cries, in our fears, in our hopes. We lay them down before the throne of grace. In this time of need, Lord, we ask your help. And we pray from our spirits the prayer that Jesus gave to the whole church when together he encouraged us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This morning, in preparation for God's word, I invite you to stand and to join me, calling upon God to search us, to know us, and to cleanse us. This morning, Lord willing, we are beginning a new series as we enter into the fall season. One of the things I learned on my two trips to Israel is something that the Jewish people and Christians who have experienced the land of Israel know to be true. That the land of Israel, the geography of the Holy Land, is the fifth gospel. We, of course, are well familiar with Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But the geography of the Holy Land has as much bearing upon the truth that God is sharing in his word that it's good for us occasionally to pay attention to the places where some of these formative biblical events take place. And one of the places where a lot of the action takes place in the Bible is in the valleys of the Holy Land. Now, we perhaps are more familiar with mountaintop experiences. And there are a number of mountaintop experiences to be found in the Bible. Moses receiving the Ten Commandments, Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. But what is really interesting is when we look at the mountains of Israel, they are places of revelation. They're generally places where God is speaking truth into the lives of his people. But it is in the valleys where the action of Scripture takes place. In particular, in the Old Testament, there are seven primary valleys. And it is in these valleys where a lot of the very familiar stories that we know in the Bible are found. And so I purpose over the next few weeks to look at some of these valleys, some of these experiences, lessons learned there. Places like the Valley of Elah, where David fought Goliath. The Valley of Eshkol, where the spies went and found these grapes that were the size of basketballs. The Valley of Sin, the Valley of Choice, the Valley of places where God shows himself through the actions of his people. And today we're going to begin with one of the earliest valleys referenced in the Bible. It is found in the book of Genesis, the book of beginnings. I invite you to turn with me to Genesis chapter 13. Genesis chapter 13. And we pick up in the midst of the story of Abraham and Lot. Abram was called by God to leave his home country and to travel to the land of promise. And with Abraham came his nephew Lot. And as the Lord blessed Abraham, he also blessed Lot. Yet as always, when families are together too long, the potential for conflict arises. And so wisely, Abraham wants to meet it head on, and that's where our text begins this morning. Genesis chapter 13, beginning at verse 8. So Abram, this is Abraham before he makes the commitment to God, the sacrifice of Isaac. So Abram said to Lot, "Let's not have any quarreling between you and me, or between your herders or mine, for we are close relatives. Is not the whole land before you? Let's part company. If you go to the left, I will go to the right. If you go to the right, I will go to the left." Lot looked around and saw that the whole plain of the Jordan towards Zoar was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt. This was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So Lot chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan and set out towards the east. The two men parted company. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, while Lot lived among the cities of the plain and pitched his tents near Sodom. Now the people of Sodom were wicked and were sinning greatly against the Lord. I invite you to keep your Bible open to this section of Scripture, because we're going to be referring to a few chapters as we go along this morning. The Bible, most of us know, is one continuous story from beginning to end. It is the story of God, the story of God's interaction with his people, God's story of rescue for a people who are lost. But part of that larger story is made up of smaller stories. And as I was thinking this week about the story before us, the story of the Valley of Siddim, because that's what we're talking about today, is the Valley of Siddim, I read a lot of pulps. Now, pulps were very, very popular in the 1930s and 40s. They were 10-cent cheaply published magazines, things like The Shadow, Doc Savage, The Spider, and others. Some of the older adults may remember those. But they're interesting because the stories are kind of written in serial form, that each chapter kind of has this cliffhanger and makes you want to read on. And so I've been reading these pulps lately, and I began to look at this story of Lot in the Valley of Siddim. And I realized that what we really have here is one of those kind of pulp adventures, that it reads like an action story. And so I want to look at it in this form. I want to look at the adventures of Lot in the Valley of Siddim. And I want to give it one of those fancy names like those pulp magazines had. I want to talk about this story as the geography of sin. The geography of sin. And hopefully you'll understand as we get into it what is going on. And so I want to look at this story of Lot as it begins here in chapter 13, as it continues into chapter 19. And I want us to kind of look at each chapter, in a sense, to see what is going on with Lot, his adventure in the Valley of Siddim, and then draw a lesson for us from Lot's adventures or misadventures, as the case may be. But you've got to set the setting first. You've got to know where the story takes place. Now, how many of you know what the lowest point on earth is? Anybody know what it is? Lowest point on earth. Lowest point on earth is the Dead Sea in Israel. The Dead Sea in Israel is the lowest point you can go on earth. And I have been that low twice. Now, the Dead Sea, of course, most of us know, is a salt sea where the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan, kind of empties into this desolate location. The level of salt is so high in the Dead Sea that you cannot sink. I could lay in the Dead Sea and even I would float. Nothing lives in the Dead Sea. It is hot, it is barren, it is full of little bubbling hot springs. This is the Dead Sea today. Yet it was not always so. You see, the Dead Sea, scientists, archaeologists, geologists tell us, was the location of two of the most prosperous cities in the land of Cana, the city of Sodom and the city of Gomorrah, referenced in our text this morning. And the city of Sodom and Gomorrah were located in the Valley of Siddim, S-I-D-D-I-M, for those who are taking notes. And the Valley of Siddim in the time of Lot is not like the Dead Sea now. It was a place of life. It was a place of vitality. In fact, what does it say? It says it was like a well-watered garden. What garden? The garden of the Lord. What's the garden of the Lord? The Garden of Eden. Like the land of Egypt, the most progressive civilization of the day. So here's the setting. The main character, of course, is Lot. We said he is the nephew of Abraham. He is a young man who has come into prosperity, who has come into possessions and wives and families. So he is very, very well to do. And this is where the story begins. So let's start with chapter 1. Chapter 1, entitled Lot's Choice. And that's what we find in our text this morning. That because of the difficulty getting along between Abraham and Lot and their various entourages, they decided to make a split. And so Abraham, even though he was the older, even though he was the one to be respected and honored, he gave the choice to his nephew. And he said, choose where you want to go, any place in the whole land. You go one way, I will go the other, and we'll divide it up that way. Now, I remember hearing about this, and I often wondered, you know, why did Lot make the choice that he did? It wasn't until, you know, we read the text a little closer that we hear that it's like the Garden of Eden. It's like the civilization of Egypt. There are these prosperous cities, Sodom and Gomorrah there. The reason Lot made the choice that he did to go to the right, which would be the east, is because it was a desirable place. It was a place brimming with possibility. It was a place dripping with prosperity. It was the big city with the glimmering lights and the allure to this young man. And he made the choice because it was a good choice. He made the choice because on the surface, it was the best place that he could imagine that he would go. Yet the text says this was before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. That's chapter 1, Lot's choice. I'm going to choose this beautiful location because it's desirable to me. So what's the lesson of chapter 1? Well, we're talking about the geography of sin, aren't we? We're talking about God and his judgment upon sin, God and his destruction of sin. And the first lesson is this from Lot's choice, is that sin is always desirable. If sin were ugly, if sin were grotesque, if sin were painful, nobody would choose it, would they? But sin is attractive. Sin is bright lights, big city. Sin is it is the allure. Sin is the promise of prosperity, of pleasure. And Lot fell into the same trap that you and I often do. If sin were ugly, none of us would choose it, but sin masquerades as something that's desirable. To have a little money, to have a little pleasure, to have a little possession or position in the world. And so people look with their eyes and they always choose that which is most desirable to them when they don't think spiritually. So Lot makes his choice here in chapter 1. Well, you know what, Abraham? I'm going to go with this. I'm going to go with the Garden of Eden. I'm going to go with the nation of Egypt. I'm going to go with the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. And that's how the first chapter ends. Lot makes a choice based on his emotional response. He makes a choice based on what his eyes are telling him to be the truth. He makes a choice based on his base desires. That looks good and I want some of it. Now, the cliffhanger. This was before God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. Well, how does this turn in chapter 2? Chapter 2 is in chapter 14. And this chapter I'm going to call Lot's Capture. Chapter 14 is about a conflict between the five kings of the Valley of Siddim who go to war against their overlords, the four kings. And like something out of The Lord of the Rings, you have this tremendous battle between these kings. But the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah and the other kings of the valley, they are defeated, they are routed. And there's a couple of things to note over in chapter 14 on what happens when they have this particular rout. Look at verse 10. Now the Valley of Siddim, that's the location of our story, was full of tar pits. Now some translators say it's not tar pits, it's slime pits. But take it as it will. When the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled, some of the men fled into them and the rest fled to the hills. What happened is the armies routed. Where did they run? They try to run away in the valley and they end up falling into these slime pits, into these tar pits. They are ensnared. They are captured. And so are the cities of the Valley of Siddim. And one of those captives was Lot. And Lot and all of his possessions were captured. What's going to happen to Lot? Well, that's another chapter in the story. Well, what do we learn from this description of the Valley of Siddim? What do we learn about what happens to those who live in the Valley of Siddim with its bright lights and big cities? Well, we learn from Lot's capture that sin is always deceptive. Sin is always deceiving. All Lot saw was that beautiful valley. But he didn't see the slime pits. He didn't see the tar pits. He didn't see the warfare that was right underneath the surface. And when it was scraped away by the violence of this invasion, did Lot start to think, maybe I didn't make the right choice. Now, what's the lesson? Well, the lesson of chapter 2 is that sin will deceive us. That it looks beautiful and glittery at first glance, but all that glitters is not gold, is it? That sin beneath the surface is a trap, a tar pit, a spiritual slime pit. And that those who dally, as Lot did, living near Sodom, they're going to have a rude awakening. And that sin will always show its ugly side at the most inconvenient time. And the trap will be sprung. And you'll be sinking in the mire. You'll be captured. How will you escape? That's what's going on here for Lot. Now, intervening in this story of Lot is Abraham. Now, the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah, they are routed, they are captured, the people are being hauled away. So God's agent, Abraham, puts together his own little mercenary force, his own little special forces team, and he goes and he rescues Lot. Brings him back, rescues all the citizens of Sodom and Gomorrah, brings them back. And for that, Abraham is blessed by King Melchizedek, but that's a different story. We're looking at Lot's story today. Rescued from the miry pits. Yet where does chapter 3 go with the story of Lot? He should have realized that sin was deceptive, that living near Sodom was a mistake. And that he should praise God and thank Abraham for his deliverance from that place. But Lot doesn't learn his lesson. And so when we look at chapter 4 of the story of Lot and the geography of sin, we find ourselves over in chapter 19. Now remember, at the beginning of the story, Lot made his choice. And in making his choice, the text says he pitched his tents near the city of Sodom. Just close enough to enjoy the benefits of sin, but not quite, right? Sometimes we're like that. You know, we'll just get close to the line and see what happens, but we can always pull back. Well, that didn't work for Lot. He was captured, deceived, but he hasn't learned his lesson. Now, before chapter 19, we have the visit by God and the angels to Abraham. And of course, they receive the good news that Abraham and Sarah are going to have the child of promise, Isaac. But then, two of the men get up to leave. And then it says that the Lord says, "Should I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do?" And there on a mountaintop, Abraham receives a revelation from God that he is going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. Verse 18, "Then the Lord said, the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is so great and their sin so grievous that I will go down and see if what they have done is as bad as the outcry that has reached me. If not, I will know." And this is when the big bargaining begins. And again, another story, the story of Abraham bargaining for the souls of the people in Sodom and Gomorrah. But suffice it to say, God is sending his agents of destruction upon the citizens of this sinful valley of Siddim. But where do we find Lot in chapter 3? Verse 19, "The two angels arrived at Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gateway of the city." story begins, he's with his group outside the city. Near, but not in. Now it says he is sitting in the gateway. And we need to remember that when we read in the Bible that someone sits in the gateway, that means someone has obtained a place of authority, a place of respect, a place of honor. Lot now is no longer outside the city of sin. He is inside the city of sin. Not only is he inside the city of sin, he is a leading citizen in the city of sin. And then we have this horrific story of what happens when these holy ones of God come into this place in the valley of sin. And Lot says, you got to come into my house. No, we're going to sleep outside. No, you got to come into my house because these people are evil. They're wicked. And what happens, of course, the citizenry comes and they want to assault these holy angels of God. They bring all of their rage. They bring all of their wrath. They bring all of their lust to bear in an all-out assault upon Lot's house. But look what Lot does. What does Lot do? You know how the story goes. What does Lot do? It says he opens the door and he says, tell you what, don't touch these individuals. If you leave them alone, I will give you my daughters. I will give you my daughters to do with as you will. Chapter 3, Lot's compromise. Even though Lot had been delivered after the capture of Sodom and Gomorrah, he returned. And not only did he returned in even greater degradation. And that's what happens with sin. Sin is ultimately degrading. Bible says, you know, like a dog returning to its own vomit. That's the graphic. People keep returning to sin. People keep allowing themselves to be ensnared by sin. They keep coming back, even though they know that that which is desirable is deceptive and is going to lead to their capture, is going to lead to them sinking deeper and deeper into the tar pits and the mire pits of spiritual depravity. Yet, there we find Lot again, compromising. Not only is he in the city, he's a leading citizen of the city. Not only does he kind of look the other way when the people express their sinfulness. And what is the sinfulness of Sodom and Gomorrah? A lot of people say, well, it's the sin of homosexuality. Well, that's one of the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah. It's the prominent one, perhaps, here in chapter 19. But throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament, it talks about, first of all, yes, there's sexual immorality of all shapes, colors, and stripes. Over in Ezekiel 16, it says that they were selfish and lazy. They didn't care about other people. In Isaiah 3, it said they had no sense of shame, that they paraded their sin before all who could see. That's what sin does. It brings us deeper and deeper and degrades us. And look at that degradation of Lot. A man who was blessed by God along with Father Abraham, but he has reached a point in his life where he is willing to turn his own daughters over into the hands of a depraved mob. And that's what happens with sin. Happens when you compromise with sin. When you say, just a little bit, just a little bit, just a little bit more, I can always pull back. It just keeps pulling us deeper and deeper. Well, where's Lot's story going to go? One who started with such promise, such hope, one bad choice has now led him to this point where he is in the very heart of the city in which God is going to judge. Well, that's what the rest of chapter 19 is about. The angels of God say, enough is enough. And they blind the citizenry of Sodom. And there's something to be said there about the blindness that sin causes in our lives. But he says, you've got another choice. I'm going to give you a second chance. What are you going to do with it? And so the angels proceed to take Lot and his wife and his daughters to lead them to safety. And verse 17 of 19 says, as soon as they had brought them out, one of them said, flee for your lives. Don't look back. Don't stop anywhere in the plain or in the valley. Flee to the mountains or you will be swept away. Lot's got a choice. Chapter 4 is all about Lot's second chance. You got a choice, Lot. You can flee or you can fry. And that's not hyperbole. That's literally the choice. You can flee, you can fry, because God is going to bring his fiery judgment upon the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah, upon this beautiful Garden of Eden-like Egyptian bright light big city location. God's going to destroy it. You've got a chance, Lot, to get away. You need to flee. But what's the lesson of Lot's second chance? First is this, that sin is doomed. That God is not going to allow sin to exist in his world. He's not going to allow it to exist in the lives of his people. That he has promised judgment. And you have a chance to change. A choice to be made. You can flee the wrath to come, the Bible says. Or you can endure what God is bringing upon the nations. And there's the cliffhanger. What is Lot going to do with his second chance? Now, if you read a little further on the story, he starts making bargains. He says, Lord, you know, I can't make it that far. Can you let me stay a little bit closer? Can I get as far as Zoar? Can I still stay in the Valley of Siddim and be okay? And God allows Lot to do that. But sin is going to be doomed. Sin is going to be destroyed. And that's how chapter 4 ends, with Lot's second chance. God gives you and I second chances. Time and time again, God says, flee the wrath to come. Time and time, God says, I am bringing judgment upon this sin, upon the wickedness of this world. You can get away from it, but if you choose to be a part of it, there is a price to pay. I'm not going to get into the whole concept of eternal salvation. Suffice it to say that if we continue in our sin, God will make us pay a price in this world. There will be temporal consequences, even for the saints who choose to live in the valley of sin. How does the story end? Well, the story ends with God's destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Listen to what happens. The Lord rained down burning sulfur on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of heaven. Thus he overthrew those cities in the entire plain, destroying all those living things in the city and also the vegetation in the land. Lot's wife looked back and she became a pillar of salt. God destroys Sodom and Gomorrah. God destroys the evil of that land. And this beautiful garden-like place in the Valley of Siddim becomes this burned-out plain, becomes this place of sulfur pits, of desolation, and the salt water just kind of congeals, quite literally, in this place that was once such a place of beauty. We don't talk about the Valley of Siddim anymore because it's gone. It's underwater. It's been completely overwhelmed by the Dead Sea. That's kind of how the story ends. We won't get into the fact that Lot keeps stumbling and bumbling throughout his life. We won't get into the sin of Lot and his daughters. But with the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, the story of the Valley of Siddim ends. That piece of geography is gone. Yet the lessons that it leaves are enduring. And I thought about that when I looked at the Valley of Siddim and I was trying to find the location the first time, because I didn't remember that the Valley of Siddim was where Sodom and Gomorrah was. That it exists at the lowest point on earth. And that's true of sin. Sin exists at the lowest point of our lives. The lowest point of a believer's life is when we are deceived by sin. And we are caught in the slimy pits, the tar pits, when we are continually being sucked down. Because that's what will happen. Unless we allow the rescue of God to lift us up and put our feet upon higher ground. That if we continue to play with sin like Lot played with sin, starting on the fringes and then becoming a grand citizen of a city of sin, there's always going to be a price that has to be paid. You realize that all that Lot had, all the possessions, all of the treasures, all of the servants, everything that Lot had was gone. He escaped by the skin of his teeth, just he and his daughters. He had nothing left. And this was a saint of God. Are we any different than that? So today, as we look at this first valley, the Valley of Siddim, think how low it actually went. To be a place so desirable, something that Lot wanted so desperately, and how it became this place of death that exists today. Someone has said this. It says, sin will take you further than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. Let me say that again. Sin will take you further than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and will cost you more than you want to pay. That could be the final lines of the story of Lot and his adventures in the Valley of Siddim. He never would have expected to be brought so low. That one foolish choice would set off a misadventure that would cost him nearly everything that he had. Think about the choices that you and I make every day. Consider how we choose the things that we choose, the things that we want. Is the glittering false gold of sin deceiving our eyes only to ensnare us in a slimy pit? Do we presume upon God's rescue that as God saved us before, he will save us again? That he will get us out every time we get ourselves in too deep? Will there come a time that we, like Lot, will sit in the gate of the city of sin and the Valley of Siddim? Will there come a point when the only chance we have is to flee, surviving with only the clothes upon our back? Know that sin will take you further than you want to go, keep you longer than you want to stay, and will cost you more than you want to pay. This is the lesson of the Valley of Siddim. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we look at the story of this place, a place that seemed to offer so much prosperity, so much potential, yet it turned out to be a slimy pit. And Lot, in his compromise, lost all that he had. Father, we would not be like Lot. Help us not to pitch our tents near the Sodoms of this world. Help us not to be deceived by those things which glitter and are in truth not gold. When we fall into the fiery pits, Lord, and you lift us up from those places of capture, may we flee from our sin. May we not be forced at the end to give up so much to escape by your grace. Father, may we learn the lesson well of the geography of sin, of the Valley of Siddim, and may we realize the consequence of playing with sin. We pray that we might even now flee, In the power of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Now I belong to Jesus. Verse 2 in particular reminds us of what we have been saved from through the power of God's love. Let's stand as we sing, "Now I Belong to Jesus." Time we'll receive our morning offering. Let us pray. Father, you have blessed us time and time again. You have given us true wealth and true prosperity. We pray that out of the abundance of your blessing, we would give and give to your praise, honor, and glory. Amen. may the amazing grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, his people, now and forever. Amen.